I'd like to thank you and welcome you to the IID's 1 o'clock business meeting. At this time, we'd like to have the Pledge of Allegiance. Ziad, would you lead us in the pledge, please? I pledge allegiance to the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Mr. Taylor, are there any actions taken in closed session to report?
No, ma'am.
Okay. On the approval of the agenda, we have two items that are going to come before this board. Number one is the resolution declaring emergency within the Imperial Irrigation District. And then we have a presentation by Ms. Barber regarding contribution to the city of Coachella for their solar program. So those will be included right after information and energy. With those items added to the agenda, are there any items to be pulled or added? If not, could I have a motion to approve the agenda?
Can I pull number six on the CM?
Okay, that would be good.
Okay, with that, I'll move for approval of the agenda with number six pulled on a consent.
Is there a second?
Second.
Please vote. This is a time for public comment. Please come before the podium and state your name for the record. Anyone that'd like to come in and speak to the board, this is the time to do so.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
My name is Steve Zemensky. I'm the CEO of Solar Gen 2. It's a solar development company focused on developing projects here in the valley. And the purpose of stepping up here is really just to more appropriately introduce myself, the company, and let you know a little bit about what we're up to and what our schedule is. Delighted to report that we have signed a material agreement. It's a 150 megawatt power purchase agreement with San Diego Gas and Electric Company to build a project here in Imperial to sell to San Diego Gas and Electric. It's a 25-year agreement. Our project schedule is to try and finish up the preliminary development work by the end of this year and begin construction at the end of this year and finish it up by the third quarter of 2012. I wanted also to very much thank the staff, the board, senior management of the Imperial Irrigation District for your help and guidance in navigating what has been a very difficult task of opening up Imperial to the rest of California. We've been at this for years, and it was a very difficult thing. And I think the leadership and the vision that you've shown was instrumental in allowing us to move this far. We've still got a ways to go. We've got more projects to do, and we got to finish this one up. But we're delighted to be here before you today to report that we've got a major milestone in the project development schedule down, hopefully some of the other tasks in front of us are more manageable. But we're delighted to be working with you. Thank you for your time and consideration. And I also wanted to thank Jesse Montano, who I'm looking for and not seeing here. There he is. And the rest of our SolarGen team here. And we're very much committed to trying to do everything we can to bring jobs here and make sure that the economic development that happens here for the benefit of the people in the valley.
Thank you. Comments or questions from the board? I know this is public comment, but first time we get a presentation from this company, anything. I just want to welcome you and your staff and the generators here to the Imperial Valley. This is probably one of the first practical projects that are going to go forward, and you're opening the gate for the rest of them, and I appreciate that, and I thank you. And I also am grateful that our staff is working with you to make this happen. And so it's a good thing for everybody. It's a good beginning.
Thank you. And if at any point, you know, there's issues, questions, anything, I offer up myself. Whenever you have something, please let me know. I'd be delighted to work through it with you.
Oh, don't worry. I'll call you if I have issues. I will call you, so you don't have to worry about that. But anyway, welcome to the Imperial Valley.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your time.
Director Hanks.
Yeah. Steve, I'd just like to make a comment. You know, this has been a long struggle, and I, unless people have really been involved with it, I don't think they really have an appreciation for the amount of work that it included. See, this is a, as far as I know, this is the first PPA through to San Diego Gas and Electric from the Imperial Valley. So rewriting agreements and contracts was at ground zero. And the other issue at the time, through our Imperial Valley sub, we had no resource adequacy credits. This project will open that door. And basically what you're doing, you're providing credits for the next development. So it's very important to get this first project through. Sometimes I begin to wonder if we were going to get any through. So we still have a lot of work ahead of us. But I appreciate you staying the course. You might share with the audience some of the projects that you've done. I think that it was pretty impressive.
Jim, do you mean the prior projects I've worked on, or this
yes.
one in particular? This I've completed 12 other greenfield development projects in my career, which started with a California entity out of Irvine, California, called Ultra Systems back in 1986. And I've worn a lot of hats in my career, but one of the things I've done is I was a developer of utility scale projects. We used to manage an energy fund, and that fund has financed a 50 megawatts solar photovoltaic plant in Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario. And as of last August, when that was financed, it was the largest photovoltaic plant in North America. And 30 megawatts of that one's up right now, and the rest will come online this summer. More recently, here in California, in 2009, in support of a 15-year power purchase agreement with PG&E, I built a 120-megawatt peaker that came online in May of 2009, on time, on budget. In support of that PPA, and I won't bore you with the rest of the list, but been pretty active here in California for a long time, 25 years. So.
That's good to know.
Steve, I appreciate you coming forward and giving the presentation and the handout, but I think some of the credit to what you're doing goes to Jesse Montano, an XID employee.
Absolutely.
And I know he's worked very hard on trying to bring this forward, and also to ZAD with Z Global. They both put a lot of time and effort into making this possible and bringing you forward. So I hope all the success in the world, because it's very important to Imperial Valley to get this project moving.
Absolutely. Thank you for reminding me.
As much as I'd like to talk to you, I'd like to have ZAD come to the podium and say a few words. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you.
Excuse me. Yeah, thank you. I mean, I'm Ziad Aliwan. Hi, Mike. And I think it's a really good day. You know, this Steve experience is, I think, speaks for itself. He's very humble. I helped, you know, Steve in a lot of other projects before I sort of brought him here and say, look, you know, this is a really good place. to invest. And but I think, I mean, I really want to thank all of you here, and I'm not just saying that, you know, I think everybody played the role in this. It was a very difficult negotiation with San Diego. It's the most difficult I have been in my career. I don't know, Steve, you have negotiated a lot more PPAs in your career, but it was difficult. Hopefully this is will be the gate to get more project. I think we, Z Global, is committed to bring folks here to the Valley, because I think all the years I had training and understanding the IID systems and how things work, trying to leverage that, and I think it's been good. Hopefully we can expand our operations. We're helping other folks also develop projects here. You know, there is, I think today was the last day for bidding into PPAs, into PG&E, Southern Cal Edison, and San Diego Gas Electric. So there is a lot of projects that are from here, Imperial, that have submitted bid, different, you know, developers. Beside all the board members here, I want to thank Mr. Kelly here, general manager. He's been very helpful, very straightforward. And I want to thank Dr. Kolk for helping getting these agreements. It's the first agreement for solar that I think IID is signing, hopefully soon, that will export energy to San Diego. It's in the works. It's coming. I want to thank the staff, the engineers, and the engineering staff for, really kind of working with us on this, because at the time, I think at one time, folks looked at this project and they want this project to be built in 12 months. This is supposed to go in operation in July 2012. It's not impossible to do, but it cannot be done without you guys. I mean, we got to build it connected to the grid in 12 months. So I'm sure people who have done this before appreciate the challenge. So we really need every help we can get. And we're just, are grateful for a lot of folks to look at us and saying, okay, you know, we're trying to do the right thing and not trying to get some, bypass the IID tariff or anything else. We want to go through the process. We want to work with you, and hopefully so we can build more and more projects. So that's...
My first experience with Mr. Alawan and C Global was when they were retained by the district on the PowerLink transmission line to do a prudence review. I was very impressed by your intelligence and your dedication, and actually we ended up saving millions of dollars because of the review. And so I have a lot of trust in what you're able to do, and I just hope that our staff will work with you to move this project forward and get going. Like I said, this is the first one, and it'll open the gates to other ones, and so we have to move forward, and time is of the essence.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Montaño, want to say a few words?
Yeah, make him come.
Come on.
Come on, homeboy.
Being from the Valley, Jesse Montaño, work for Z Global. Being from the Valley, I'm really excited about these projects. You know, the first one's interconnecting to the IID transmission system and wheeling into California markets. And like Ziad and Steve has said, this is, it's been a learning experience, because we've had to deal with issues that were really affecting the whole Imperial Valley projects interconnecting, like the resource adequacy. And I don't think that these issues could not have been resolved, and we could not have come to a resolution on some of these issues if it wasn't for the IID, Kevin Kelly's, Dr. Koch. You know, this project, I think a couple of times it really seemed like it was dead, but we were able to...
You gave it CPR?
We were able to resuscitate it, you know, things that, you know, with working together with Dr. Koch and his staff, we were able to work on the project and able to get it back up and going. And so we really do are very appreciative of the work, because it's a collaborative effort that is making this project a success and will make projects in the future success here in the Imperial Valley. You know, the renewable resources are there. You know, the industry is right the industry is ready to explode here in the Imperial Valley, I believe, and provide jobs to this valley. And like Ziad said, you know, I'm from the valley, born and raised here in the valley, and I think that is our focus, is to provide jobs to the Imperial Valley, help the economy down here in the Imperial Valley, and sell into California markets. And I really do, like, you know, I've been working on this project since September, and I really do believe that this project would not have been, we would not be where we're at if it not had been the support from the IID, from the county, from Kevin Kelly, Dr. Koch, his staff, Jamie, Joel Ivey, everybody that has been working with us to get these projects up and running. And we're working an interconnection agreement. You'll see all those other agreements coming to you pretty soon. We're working on them, as a matter of fact, just before I came over here. So thank you for your support. There's other projects.
Those agreements will be here with, like, in 24 hours.
And it's I think, you know, we're working
48 hours.
Yeah, we're working on them right now. We're working with Dr. Koch and his staff, but they've been very helpful and instrumental and like I said, resuscitating these projects. I think that, like I said, the RA was a big hurdle that we had to overcome, but there's the IID with the county and the task force, Kevin, Jennifer, Dr. Koch, Steve Keen, everybody that's been working on these issues. I think that now we're starting to see the logjam kind of break a little bit, and hopefully, you know, we'll see additional projects coming begin to come to generation and come to fruition. Thank you.
That's one of the reasons why this board has supported this, because this is going to, like I said, open the floodgates to other projects.
We hope that that's the case, Madam President.
And that's why I gave you all more than 5 minutes under public comment.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Not going to happen again, though. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else like to come and speak before the board? There was a gentleman that was walking up here. And did he leave?
No, he didn't leave.
Oh, okay. All right, then if no more public comment, then turn it over to the board members. Director Sanchez?
No comment.
Director Menville?
Yes, thank you, President Mendoza. On Wednesday, the 6th of July, I know Bruce Wilcox, he's in the audience here. Bruce Wilcox and Director Desert and myself and Supervisor Kelly, Supervisor Renison, and then James Lowell all took a little trip up to the Managed Marsh in an IID van. Then we went out to the Playa, to the Alamo Outlet and the New River Outlet. Then we went on over to by Cuatro del Mar's project by the sea towards the Elmore Ranch, and looked at the issues out there with the receding salt in the sea. And so thought it was a good trip. We all had lunch at the Aspen afterwards and talked about some of the things that county and the IID could do in trying to work together to help mitigate some of the issues on the Salton Sea. On Thursday, I spent 2 hours with a supervisor's introduction to Cal OSHA's regulations. Richard Fernstein gave the class with about 20 employees. I found that pretty interesting. I think maybe the board itself should have a little update on some of the safety issues dealing with Cal OSHA. I think it would be very helpful what some of the employees have to go through in dealing with safety issues. On Friday, I know we had the storm damage Thursday night down in Clexico, lost about 40 poles on the north side of the All-American along Levine Road. I went down there Friday, and they had the everything set up down. Everybody was working hard. I know there's going to be a report on that, but we took a pretty good hit down there, and then we also had a second storm roll through a couple of days later. But all the IND employees were working pretty hard out there in the afternoon when the heat was really on. And yesterday morning, Director Hanks and I met with Tim Kelly from IVEDC and Gary Wyatt and John Renison on some issues with IVEDC and the enterprise zones. And we're going to look into, and I've already talked to Diane Kaysen about trying to do something with some of the marketing, the money that's being spent on marketing IVEDC and enterprise zones, if we can't work together to make better use of some of the dollars that are out there. And then final thing I wanted to bring up today, and this is a request of the general manager, Mr. Kelly, is with all of the issues that we're having with QSA, and I know you've got another meeting with the BOR on the 27th to try to work some of the things out. From my standpoint, I think our legal team is doing an outstanding job with what they have to deal with, but I think it's time that we take a look at maybe talking to New Mexico attorney Chuck DeMars and seeing if we can bring him in here, either in private or public, to talk to him if he can in any way assist the IID and some of the issues that are going on. He's the gentleman that put out the amicus brief for the Citizens for Reliable Water Supply. It's a pretty thick brief. I've gone through it about 10 times. But what catches my attention, he talks about liability, protection of the Imperial Valley, liability on the Salton Sea and everything. And I think that maybe he could assist us in some issues, even though he's from New Mexico and he understands how the upper basin on the Colorado River work. He has worked with some of the landowners here in the Imperial Valley, and I think that this board ought to take a look at talking to him, seeing what he has to say. He will be able to get a waiver from the Citizens for Reliable Water Supply, the work that he's done with them. He's finished, so he could do something with the IID, but I know it's up to this board and the general manager to make that decision. But I would like to, for this board to take it under consideration to at least talk to Chuck DeMars to see if he could be of any help in advising our legal counsel that's working on a QSA with everything that's coming down and the situation that we're involved in at this point in time.
Yeah. Director Menville, all we need is another attorney
to
advise this board and charge millions of dollars more than what we already have.
I don't think that
is going to have to be a board decision.
That's my request to this board, and the board, it's a board decision. It's up to the board.
It is.
And but I think it's time. I've been around fighting these water battles for 30 years, and I think it's time with everything that's coming down with MWD and Coachella Valley Water District changing their mind about some things that are going on. I think we better make sure that we're taking care of the Imperial Valley.
I agree with you 100% on what you just said, but to have another attorney on the payroll, I don't know, we'll have to discuss that. Director Hanks?
I love it. I'm not crazy about having more attorneys, but I'm going to support Director Menville and the statement he just made. Matter of fact, I welcome it. You know, the QSA, as we understand it, has been forced through the ruling of a judge and also through some of the commitment of some of the parties, or lack of commitment, has changed the terms and conditions. And for us to think that this is going to move forward without some type of renegotiation, some type of talks to get it back on track, I think is folly on our part. And I'm happy to hear the comments made by Director Menville that we'll have an independent party look at it and make some recommendations. Again, I'd like to go back to the breakthrough on the renewables. The IID has a contract with Sun Peak, and they're working on a 23 megawatt solar project, and then this will be the first export, and I think and hope that it's the first of many, not only for the solar, but also for renewables in general. The issue of resource adequacy of getting energy out of here is more than just power lines. It is the ability to gain purchase power agreement with the investor-owned utilities, the big three. And I think we've had a breakthrough, and I'm looking forward for this to snowball, have a snowball effect, and continue on.
Thank you. Again, Director Menville, I must say I'm very shocked by your comments regarding hiring an additional attorney. I don't know what made you change your mind or why you're going in this direction, but I was really shocked by that. And having said that, I will leave it at that. It is a discussion for the board to decide, but you shocked the hell out of me by bringing that recommendation. That's all I can say.
Well, look at the direction the QSA is moving.
Mr. Kelly, any comments?
Only that these board member comments are becoming a real opportunity to learn things for the first time.
And, you also, this is your first time as well, isn't it?
And
must be re-election time.
And as you'll recall, President Mendoza, I have met Mr. DeMars on my own, and probably it's a good thing for the board to consider divergent viewpoints, and to the extent that you want to entertain that, I'll help you to do it. I do have one thing I'd like to add on the SolarGen announcement. I wasn't as involved as our energy department has been, and I commend the job of the energy department in moving this project to the point that it became viable enough to secure a PPA. There is considerable work still to be done, and I encourage Dr. Koch and his staff to stay with it and to bring this project to fruition. I'd also like to say to the board, and I think it may come up on the natural during this meeting, that I've become convinced that IID is an organization of projects. And for the board to do its job and for the management to execute board policy, it's important that those projects be memorialized in major work authorization. So to the extent that there is an NWA and it comes before this board, we have the benefit of documentation. And so I'm going to make it my business to see that every project has an MWA and that this board has an opportunity to vote on that document.
Mr. Kelly, when you say every project, is there a dollar amount associated with the project, or is there a benchmark?
In keeping with the signing authorities that are already on the books. On a somewhat related note, I have made a change in the portfolio management office, announced that last week. Carl Stills will be heading that up on an interim basis. He's returning in that role that he held previously. And I'm pleased to announce that the gentleman sitting next to me, Vance Taylor, has agreed to serve in the new role as ethics officer. Vance made the mistake of going on vacation last week and returned yesterday and learned that he's now the ethics officer. There actually is a need for this function at IID. You shouldn't infer from that IID necessarily has a problem with ethics. But as we go forward, because we do big projects and because we're called on to build big projects on both the water and energy side, I think that this will be a useful addition to our organization. And I want to thank Vance for agreeing to do it. So with that.
Okay, Director Sanchez, did you have a comment?
Yeah, just on the PMO, are you gonna have Mr. Steeles come to the next following meeting so we can get that dotted line to the board to kind of ask him some questions, et cetera?
Certainly.
Thank you.
Mr. Taylor, any comments?
Only that I wish to express my gratitude to the board and to Mr. Kelly for entrusting me with this new role. I look forward to it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay. Having said that, we will go on with our meeting. And first, we have a presentation by Ms. Barber. Where are you? Regarding Mr. Aaron, Utilities General Manager for the City of Coachella. He will be accepting the ceremonial check on behalf of the city. Come forward, please.
Good afternoon, Madam President and members of the board. This afternoon, the City of Coachella recently completed a 408-kilowatt PV system at its water treatment facility. The city participated in IID Solar Solutions program, which provided partial funding for this particular project. IID awarded the city a rebate in the amount of $1,040,000 for this project, which was funded through the public benefits budget. We'd like to recognize the City of Coachella for embracing renewable energy and implementing this innovative energy solution. The city's elected leaders and staff have exemplified their commitment toward a sustainable future for their residents. Here with us today to accept a ceremonial check is Curtis Aaron, Utilities General Manager for the City of Coachella.
Mr. Aaron, would you like to say a few words? Few words.
I don't get 5 minutes. I won't need that. Thank you very much, President Mendoza and Board of Directors. On behalf of the Mayor and City Council for the City of Coachella, we want to thank you very much for your generous support of this project. This goes to our wastewater treatment facility. And as I was telling one of the Board of Directors this morning, that it's providing all the daytime energy for the plant right now. And it's a fantastic project. I want to thank Sabrina, Maritza, and all the other staff members that we work with IID to get this project off the ground and going, because I know it was a relatively new project. And then General Manager Kelly, he's also been instrumental as well. So thank you very much on behalf of the Mayor and City Council for your generous support of this project. Thank you.
You're welcome. Director Menville?
Yes, Mr. Aaron, I want to thank you for coming down here. I know General Manager Kevin Kelly and I were both at the groundbreaking and spoke at the groundbreaking, and we appreciate you participating in this solar project. And I want to thank Sabrina and Mardisa for helping out and helping the IID to put this project together with the City of Coachella. So thank you very much, sir. I know you're glad to get the $1 million check, but still, we appreciate what you're doing.
I've always wanted one of those big checks. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
President Ms. Mendoza and Mr. Kelly, if you could come down so we could get a couple pictures, I would greatly appreciate it.
You want one of those?
Thank you.
It's already been spent.
Long gone.
Number seven on your agenda, page 70, Energy General Matters. Dr. Cope? I thought we did that already. We did, because we're doing the consent agenda and we're moving, removing item number six. Please vote.
No, you haven't approved. We haven't approved the consent.
I need a motion to approve and a second.
I move to approve the consent.
Second?
Second.
Deleting number six for a discussion, correct?
Right.
Please
right.
vote. Okay. Thank you, Ms. Rivera. You keep me on my toes. Thank you. Moving on to general matters, Dr. Koch.
Yes, Madam President. I have two very minor things, and then I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Escalera to provide an update of the storm damage this weekend. And from our point of view, it is a single storm that occurred just for emergency repair. The first, Mr. Joe Gatlin, who is our project manager at El Centro 3, resigned effective August 1st.
What'd you do to him?
It's unspecified reason, sir, madam. We're quickly looking for a replacement. I am concerned without having our own person on staff overseeing the project, just as we're bringing in large pieces of equipment as opposed to ground level and below ground level, that we have potential for additional costs. So we're interviewing this week for a potential replacement.
Are there any local people that would qualify for that, or are they?
We are looking for anybody who qualifies, we are looking at. There's not too many people who have built a 150 megawatt, quarter billion dollar facility in the local area. So it's an area of significant concern to us to get this position filled and a contract out to somebody who can come in August 1st, guide the project through the rest of the construction phase, and then, as always happens with these types of projects, from the construction phase into the litigation phase.
Okay.
So. Will the project manager be around long enough to make a transition?
He's leaving August 1st. That's one of the reasons that we're trying to get somebody in by the 20th to 24th. Trying to do that.
Okay.
The second very minor issue is at the last board meeting, Director Desert, who isn't here today, requested the resource stack. Those have now been provided for 2009, 2010, and forecasted for 2015. So those have been done. With that, I'd like to bring Mr. Escalera up. Oh, there he is. I did ask him to stay in his blue jeans that he's been in for the last 5 days, but he decided to go home and change. So,
thank you, Madam President, boards. As Dr. Koka mentioned, what I'd like to do is provide you with an update. We are treating this as one long activity, as there really wasn't much of a break between the first event and the second event. The first event, but I'll do it in phases if I may. The first event, or phase one, started about 4:15 on Thursday. We had high winds, very localized rain in east of Calexico, the intersection of Highway 98 and Barker Road. Very, very localized. In fact, for those of you that aren't familiar with that area, that's actually where Western is located. We had poles down east of Barker and west of Barker between, but you went north of quarter mile, half mile, Calexico, and they just received light rain. Looking at it, at the weather report later on that night, this red dot of storm popped open just as it popped in the weather, just over Mexicali, went to Calexico, and then just literally disappeared. We lost a total of 21 transmission poles for the P line. In addition to that, we lost 15 poles for distribution. We had a total of about 400 customers out at our high point. We were able to bring in, if not all, the great majority of those 400 customers in within about 2 hours once we were on site. On this particular project, we had a total of 7 crews. We had 3 IID crews and actually brought in our IRB crews from here and then brought the 2 IRB crews from Calexico, working them on 12-hour shifts. What would have typically taken us about 2 weeks worth of work, they were able to accomplish, have the line up and up and re-energize that Saturday evening, which now I'm glad we, not only was it great work and on their part, but I'm glad we got it done so that we could then take the next hit, which happened on Sunday about 5:30. Going back to the one that was located in Calexico, though, that we had some damages to some homes. We had SEI. We had make sure we contacted the homeowners to assist them in repairs of their homes. I do want to, at this point, thank the residents of Calexico. They were very understanding of the situation, not only of the fact that they were out of power, but the power line actually laid across Highway 98, so we had to reroute them to, is it Railroad Boulevard, I guess it is. And so we had that. The customers that were homes that were damaged were quite understanding, and we want to thank them for their patience. But also doing is the Border Patrol, Caltrans, Highway, the county and the city, the agencies were also extremely cooperative. Border Patrol actually did traffic control for us for quite a while till Caltrans was able to set up their barricades, and so was the county. We also want to commend emergency response. They were really first one that I know of. They were there very quickly, set up a control center. We brought down their trailer. We used it as a cool center for the crews. It's been a hot weekend, and we also had assistance from heavy equipment, water department, and of course stores. The estimated cost for phase one, or the one located on Thursday, we estimate that'll be in the neighborhood of about between $600,000 to $1 million. We're dealing with poles that are 70 foot high. This is, it's about a mile's worth of line that we had to replace, plus not including the distribution poles. Just about the time that we were done and we were getting, the crews were taking their breath, and we were trying to just schedule up the cleanup on Sunday, another storm hit us, this one about a mile east of Calexico, same present location, right about where the old Bravo Ranches used to be. This one, again, was very localized. Lots of rain, lots of wind. This one actually brought down about 63 of our transmission poles, double circuit, 92 plus a 34.5 underbuilt, which is about 3 miles. Including in those, we also lost 9 distribution poles that fed various commercial businesses close to the port of entry. In other words, we've lost poles. If you take the port of entry, we lost poles east of the port of entry, west of the port of entry. And these are pretty massive poles. There was talk about, well, these are pretty old line. The P line, sections of it was built in 94, but there's some sections that are relatively new, 2001 and 2006, and it snapped those poles. We have a total of 8 crews working around the clock on that project. We have 4 crews from IID. We have 4 crews from IRB. We have 1 crew that's kind of picking up what comes up during the day. We're working 12-hour shifts. We were on 16-hour shifts, but now we're hopefully being able to conduct 12 hours on for crews, and we bring in the other 4 crews so that we're actually working at 24/7. The estimated time, we had about the same time, about 400 customers that went out. These we were able to bring out up fairly quickly because most of the damage was in the transmission line. We had scattered distribution. Our troubleshooters were extremely busy. We also brought in troubleshooters from the Brawley area, which actually helped out a lot, as some of our troubleshooters and even our linemen are what we're referring to as our timing out. They were just working to the point that allows that. So we ended, made sure that they went home. Same issue with our superintendents. They were out there most of the time, so I had to make sure that I sent them home. As Dr. Koch mentioned, I was out there, but you know, I was just kind of making sure that I stayed out of the way. Again, it's about a total of about 84 poles in total that we lost in the second phase. Estimated cost, we're estimating somewhere in the neighborhood of about $1.5 to $2 million. Again, these are high transmission poles. Just for general information, the P-line is our tie to the Calexico area off of Pi. It actually goes all the way to Pi. Well, it ties into Drop 4, and then we got another line. I think it's the C-line coming from Pilot Knob, and that's our south tie to Calexico so that it gives us a loop from, we can feed it from Al Centro, which we're doing now, power station, and if not anything, then we could feed it from our hydros, and it picks up all of the hydros along the All-American Canal. We're working on one little piece now, which is priority, and to bypass the generation from Drop 5, which typically would go to Bravo, which is a substation on the border. We'll send it up to Verde, and so we won't lose that generation. The process here is just to kind of give you an idea. You know, we have to kind of go and secure the wires, because if you can imagine, the wires are all still attached. It's just that these poles are laying, half of them hanging over the All-American Canal. The area is very restrictive. We've got the All-American Canal on one side, and I should have remembered this, what the other canal is on top. Carlos, I can't remember, and I should know that. South Alamo. So it's kind of restricted. So it's making the work a little tougher. Somehow, our crews ended up with that side, and the contractor ended up with the easier side. But I got to say that the guys are doing really well. We go in, we secure the lines, and then we start clearing out and actually taking the poles apart. And so that we leave the line in, they take everything, all the hardware off, and then our line stays in place because the line is actually not broken. Then we go in, we arm up, we come behind them like a kind of a, if you can imagine a assembly line. So we, you know, as we got crews in the front doing one work, then the others, and then now we've got, in fact, we've got crews now that are getting ready to stand up some poles. Estimated time, if we keep this schedule, it's going to take us about 2 weeks. Typically, 3 miles of line, you're talking a couple months worth of work. In general, that is kind of a really quick update. Again, I want to thank all of the agencies. I want to thank all of the other departments within the IID. They've been very cooperative. I do want to thank emergency services. They've been out there since we've been out there. Been very helpful. But again, it's tough work. It's hot. Last night finally started to cool down. We've got the water stations set out through the whole area to making sure that our guys keep hydrated. Unfortunately, you know, that doesn't help. It's muggy and it's hot, but the guys are doing really well.
Director Sanchez?
No. Kevin, have you guys decided how we're going to pay for the $1.5 million? This would be, for me, I wouldn't mind using our cash reserve, because I believe natural disasters like this should be the opportunity to use some of those cash reserves.
It's a resolution.
We have a resolution in front of you.
I know, but
to get reimbursed by FEMA.
By FEMA?
Or
what?
Cal.
Yeah.
But what if we don't?
Well, if we do it correctly and we follow protocol, we should.
Well, as you'll recall, Director Sanchez, this came up a couple times last year. The board acted. We had the declaration. I think we're awaiting some sort of state effort as well, or at least acknowledgement.
Yeah, Mr. Hatfield is after Mr. Escalera, and he'll come up here.
So our expectation is that this will follow that form, and will be reimbursed.
Mr. Escaleta, who's in charge of communications between our emergency services and the county and the state? Who's making sure that with the lines of communication are open?
Well, Mr. Hatfield is taking care of all of the communications dealing toward the agencies that deal with the emergencies. We have alternating superintendents, in the field that communicate with the EOC because the trailer is based on site. And so any updates, any information that we have or they have, we communicate with the EOC personnel, and then they relate those to outside agencies. And we've made the EOC the point of contact.
So the communication is flowing both ways, and it's working, right?
It really is. I do have to say that of all of the emergencies, at least a few that I've been involved with, this one, the EOC has been very, very active.
What you're telling me that Energy Department is communication with OEM, the team, very well.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
All right. Make sure that happens. Mr. Kelly.
You know, as a matter of fact, not to put too fine a point on it, but we are probably a little too communicative. Last week I was out of town. I heard from Mario. Thanks very much for all those updates. I heard from Jennifer, who was relaying word from Mr. Hatfield in the field. And then I heard from Dr. Koch as well. So between all three, I had it surrounded, and I was able to do what I do best, which is nothing. But I did know what was going on up to the minute, and so I think we've got a very a good system
in place. That communication is great. I'm talking about communication between the Energy Department and the Office of Emergency Management and the county and so forth, because
it's really important
that we communicate to get reimbursed.
I believe all that interagency communication is now... it all resides in our own emergency services.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. And that's correct. I mean, and if I may add just a little bit more, it allows our folks to do what they do best, which is really getting the system back up and running. And so they've taken a very active role, and we appreciate that.
Okay. Thank you.
Are you ready for action?
Huh?
Are you ready for action?
For what? No, we have Mr. Hatfield making the presentation for the resolution.
Oh,
this
okay.
was just
I don't want to take his thunder, so go ahead.
Okay.
Are you done?
Yes, ma'am, I am.
Thank you, Mr. Escalera. Director Manville?
Mario, on Friday I was on a job site in the afternoon and looked at the damage, the holes in the houses, and the crews were working very hard in the heat, like you said, and we're lucky we had the cooling trailer that they could get in there and cool off for a while, but it was brutal out there. And I know Irby was working on the other side of 98 and the IID was on the west side, but they were doing a fantastic job. It's unfortunate that Mother Nature just rolls through there and does the damage she does. But it takes a pole totally off halfway up. If you look at that thing, you wonder how that could even possibly happen, but the pole's just gone halfway up.
It literally just right down the middle. Our concern was that the one on Thursday, one on Sunday, looked really menacing, and we thought it was going to start to roll. And I'll be very honest with you, had that continued and caused the same type of damage that it did as it rolled into Heber, we had some distribution problems, or even Hopeville. I think we would have been in dire straits because it really taxed our system. We typically don't have two storms right next to each other and do damage to a relatively stout transmission line.
Were they storms? Was it a tornado? What was that?
They're little tornadoes.
That's tornado.
The way they go through there, it's the wind whipping. And I don't know, like in 2007 down there on 98, you lost all the 92 KV line, went down on 98. I think that was like $750,000 in damage, but we got reimbursed by that.
Mm-hmm. So. We think that's what it was, very localized, because there was some very strong winds on it. Just as a matter of a note, on Thursday, the poles were leaning northwest. On Sunday, the poles are now leaning southeast. So it just gives you, it's the direction of the wind is whatever Mother Nature decides to. Yet, it jumped Calexico. We assisted the water department in removing two trees out there on Cole Road. You know, those things were 4 foot in diameter, and it just knocked them out.
Wow.
But I literally just kind of jumped to the other side of the town.
Those are very, very strange sort of micro weather events. And you know, we typically, at least in my childhood, I remember that being an August sort of thing where it comes up out of the Gulf. But more associated with Arizona than here in the Imperial Valley.
Well, they've gotten their share of it. I mean, they've gotten their share just east of Yuma, and they've had some outages on that side too. So,
Mr. Scalera, appreciate you getting the power back on, because I got phone calls, and within 2 hours you got the power back on. You guys are doing a great job.
The guys have a long list of people that know have access to the board.
Yeah. Well, Mr. Scalera, thank you so much for your work and for your staff and for all the IID staff.
We'll pass it on. Thank you.
Mr. Hadfield?
Good afternoon, Jerry Hadfield. Before you, we have a resolution to declare an emergency. Yesterday, Mr. Kelly signed the proclamation declaring emergency for both storms. And the county today approved it, and it's been sent to the state, and we're waiting on word from Governor Brown. And recommend that you sign and approve this resolution.
May I have a motion to approve the resolution?
Yeah, I'll make a motion to.
Is there any discussion?
That's for power and water.
And I know that you all did a very good job. Could you name your team, Mr. Hadfield, who's been assisting the Energy Department? Who was on your team?
On my team, it's myself, Robert Amparano, Jose Contreras, and Ralph Mace has been temporarily assigned to us.
Well, from what I've heard, you've all done an outstanding job, as well as the Energy Department, and we thank you for that. Thank you. Please vote.
You're getting a good tan, too.
A little bit.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, moving on to item number 8, page 71 on your agenda, update on energy balancing report.
Good afternoon, directors. Dave Koch, Assistant General Manager, Energy. I've been asked to show each week or each month, I provide a large report to you that is somewhat incomprehensible in many cases. So I've been asked to go through very quickly what the balancing sheet is.
Is that the report that I had told you before? Don't give it to me because
yes,
I don't understand it. It doesn't make any sense.
Yes, ma'am.
Why kill trees? Okay.
The big one,
yes.
For all hours of the month.
You can keep
month.
It. I don't want it.
It does have some interesting, some valuable points. In particular, it shows how the district is making use of its day-ahead purchases and its long-term purchases, and it shows the hourly cost of meeting load with our resources. Now, the first part of it, I'm moving from left to right, shows the date, and so this is May. You'll be getting June next week. First thing we show is just the spinning reserves that we have on our system by hour. So here we're running from 32 to 50 megawatts, 54 megawatts of spinning reserve. Primarily this is the Yucca plant. Then we have our non-spinning reserves. How much additional reserves do we have on the system? Our required reserves, now here we're showing 102 megawatts. This is El Centro 4, that we're required to have contingency reserves equal to our largest single contingency, which is this amount. Then our total reserves, which is the sum of our spin and actual reserves, so 32 plus 207 in round terms, 240, 38 plus 207, 245. So right now, in for the first day in May, we're sitting there with about 250 megawatts of reserves. We also have a loss payback. This is how we pay for imports from San Juan. Our contingency, I can't read that from here, contingency reserves and CPI S1. Let me go into these two columns here very quickly. WEC and NERC defines contingency reserves as the amount equal to the loss of the single most severe contingency, which for us currently is El Centro 4. When El Centro 3 comes on, we think that we're going to be able to keep the reserves down at 104 megawatts equal to El Centro 4, because El Centro 3 will have two different units. So we don't think our reserves will go up to 105 megawatts. And we have to make sure that we have 3% of the load and 3% of net generation sitting out there. So in effect, we have to make sure at any time that we have a minimum of almost 15% of resources, around 3% of contingency for a spin, then the rest for non-spin, but stuff that can come up within an hour. In general, this is what we use the Nylon facility for, just our backup reserves. Now, our Control Performance Standard 1, CPS 1, this is primarily a frequency-sensitive evaluation of how well we're doing. As you look at it, the numbers bounce all over the place, but what you're really hoping for is to see a number of 200%, and we must keep it within 100% for the entire year for a rolling average. Its definition is relatively straightforward. It's 100% times 2 minus 1, a constant, times our frequency error. Here, the scheduled error, scheduled frequency is almost always 60 hertz. There's some few moments where we may see it scheduled to correct all the clocks in WEC. But other than that, it's always going to be 60. So if there's an error and we're at 62, for example, and then our frequency error would be 2. It's kind of interesting to me. This is a useless little factoid, unless you're really interested in this, that every clock in the Western Electric Coordinating Council spins at exactly the same rate, every electric clock, and that Edison is responsible for making sure that every clock goes at the same rate, because all those clocks count the hertz, or the frequency of the electricity in the West. And so every generator is spinning at exactly the same time, the same frequency, to produce the same power. And the only time that it ever varies is when we want to speed up the clocks or slow down the clocks to bring them back into time with the rest of the world. So I find that interesting. Apparently nobody else does, but I do. The ACE area control error, ACE, this is just the difference between our internal load and our generation. Okay, so here we can see, again, for this time period, what our actual geothermal load was. So during this time period, we're running about 490 megawatts of geothermal. We weren't importing anything internal to our system. We're exporting about 450, so there's some loss here, about 10 megawatts that we're taking away from the geothermals for their share of generation. Then we can start moving out and look at how much our contracted purchases are on each particular hour. So you can see here during the off-peak period, we're importing about 226 megawatts. By convention, any imports are shown as a negative. So we're running 226 megawatts during the off-peak period and going up to 300 megawatts during the on-peak period. We have the percentage or how much we're actually using of that. A lot of this is going to be contracts that we may or may not call upon at any time, depending upon load. Because this is May, as we get to the end of May, we're going to have less surplus on our system. But you can see that we've purchased but aren't using somewhere around 170, 180 megawatts of capacity. Here you can see that we're using around 50 or 60, jumping up here to 73% of the total capacity. Then the cost that we're paying for it, you can see that going down, that our costs vary from high of about $41 per megawatt hour down to about 31 megawatts per hour. And in the day ahead market purchases, we're not purchasing anything off peak, but we're purchasing up to 100 megawatts on peak at prices around $44. The idea here is that we are using this day ahead purchases at $44 to displace more expensive generation of our own resources within the district. We can then start looking at the resources that we have, our hydro facilities, El Central Generation 2, 3, 4, Nylon 1 and 2, the Raleigh unit. We're not using any of El Centro 2, obviously none of El Centro 3. We're using El Centro 4. At the minimum, we have to keep this on to support the Yucca plan in the event that it falls off. Where you don't have any of the Nylon or any of the Brawley units up, none of the Coachella units up. In fact, the only other resource that we have is the Yucca plant. So, in effect, what we're doing with our resources is we're keeping the hydro facilities, which are our cheapest resource available. We're keeping El Centro 4 to provide system support. We're keeping the Yucca plant to provide spinning reserves. And everything else for this time period, we're bringing in with purchases either short-term or long-term from out of state. So we're making the best use of our resources by not using them in this particular case because of the resources. Then we can see our total load, our system megawatts, and then the cost of meeting our load, what we call the system lambda, the cost of meeting an additional megawatt for each hour of the day, so that you can see that generally it's in the low 40s during this time period, although for some reason here it jumped up to about $73. So there is something that happened on the system that particular hour. And then our inadvertent megawatt hours, what we call the control area, we're running a control area error. We're running around 1 to 3 megawatts each hour. That reflects the fact that we've brought it in, we've prepared a forecast, and we're just trying to make sure that generation and load are balancing up. And this is just basically showing up by our non-spin, not balancing out perfectly at any time period. Then we have our transmission capacity, how much we have on peak and off peak. So we have a tremendous amount of capacity on peak, off peak. This is just how much we have available. This also includes all the interties, including at Devers from the ISO. And you can see we're only using around 23% of our transmission capacity. Now, again, this is due to the fact that our loads are only running about 400 megawatts, or in this case, 300 megawatts. When you move out to this time of year where our loads are running at 900 megawatts, then this is going to be a much higher number.
Dr. Cope, yes, what's the highest load we've had so far this year in the summertime?
I believe it was 920.
Do you think we'll go over 1,000 this year, this summer?
My own belief, the forecast for this year, the peak, is 983. That's our forecasted peak. And I believe that there was just a number of strange reasons last year that we jumped up that extra 50 megawatts, primarily with the schools bringing on air conditioning load earlier than normal. So I don't believe so.
You don't think it'll, okay.
No, ma'am. I hope not, because if it does, it'll be a very miserable day.
We've gone over 1,000, haven't we, or we haven't?
No, yes, sir, we have. August 20th of last year, we went up to 1,004.
Yeah. How long did it last?
Well, it was less than, it was for 1 hour.
Yeah. Any comments or questions, Dr. Cope? Director Hanks?
Yeah, just generally speaking then, with your day ahead market purchase, the more day ahead you purchase, generally the cheaper the energy?
Yes, sir. The only time we will purchase is if it economically dispatches our own other resources. It can replace either existing generation or even other firm purchases that we've made sometime in the past. So we have, for example, a dispatchable resource available during the on-peak period at $50, and there's energy available at $30. We'll shut down or reduce the day-ahead purchase to the minimum amount possible and replace it in the real-time markets. So the greater percentage that you see of our day-ahead and hour-ahead purchases, the better we're doing in the marketplace.
You know, I asked Dr. Koch to give us a presentation on this because it is very complex. And I think it also helps our public understand the need for the generators that we have. And a lot of times people say, well, why are we buying elsewhere? Why aren't we running our own generators? Because there are times whenever it's much cheaper to throttle back on our generators. But at the same time, running a balancing control area, you have to have that capability.
That's correct, sir. And except for El Centro 4 and Yucca, which we must meet to, must operate, we can move them to minimum, but we must operate them to meet the moment-to-moment variations and loads that you have. In many cases, the best use of a generator is not to operate it, to have the capacity available, but to arbitrage against that physical hedge that you have in the market and hope that the energy markets allow you to displace that energy in your stack and make use of less expensive energy. And we can meet load, but if we meet it with our own generation, it will be the most expensive way of doing it.
Yeah, there's, you know, I've heard different comments from some people in the public that believe that the success that supply and trading had was the downturn of the natural gas market. But you can clearly see that there is work going on every hour in helping reduce the costs and keep them as low as possible.
That's correct, sir. And I will also show next week that even though the gas market has gone down, our prices have gone down further, and now that we've hedged out for the 36 months, and hopefully with the board's approval up to 60, even should the market go up, our costs would rise much slower.
And basically with renewables, that will become a fixed cost, basically.
Yes, sir.
What I call a fixed cost. It would be pretty constant. You won't have the flexibility of throttling back or, you know, I mean, it's take or pay, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any comments or questions?
Yes, sir.
Is smiling or is laughing?
No. Waiting for the question.
Well, no, you guys put in a lot of work, and you come up with a lot of good information, and done a great job.
You know, I'd like sometime for you just, if possible, bring some of your supply and trading guys over here. Let us see what they look like.
I strongly suggest and invite you all to come over.
I've been there a couple of times.
She has.
More than a couple of times.
Not early for you.
Oh, no, I don't really.
Well, you see them doing the most work about 4:30 to 6. That's when most of us are in the office at that point. So it's a good time to be there.
Yeah, I'd go like at a civilized hour, like 11 o'clock in the morning, something like that.
Yes, sir.
Civilized.
It is very interesting to see as they attempt to displace in the calls and the market movements that are going on in any particular morning. making sure that we protect the reliability, that we have the transmission, and that we make the most use of our resources.
Okay, any comments? Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Very informative. A lot better than trying to read your report. Thank you. Okay, moving on to item number 9 on your agenda, page 84, AC trade-up program overview. I asked for this to be put on the agenda, Ms. Barber, because I had questions and I had customers call me and ask me, well, how does this work? I didn't realize I had to get a permit from the city. And so there was a lot of confusion. So please explain to the public how this works.
Well, good afternoon, Madam President, members of the board. My name is Sabrina with this Energy Management and Strategic Marketing. I'm here to provide an overview of our program. We did conduct 2 workshops, one here in El Centro and one also in La Quinta prior to implementing this program, just because we anticipated that we would have a number of questions from the contractors. So we held both those workshops in hopes of kind of mitigating some of the questions.
Did you get a good turnout?
We had
turnout?
An excellent turnout. In fact, Director Manville attended one of those.
It was a very good turnout. They did an excellent job. There was quite a few questions, and everything was explained very well. So you guys did a great job.
Thank you. With that being said, we've had several inquiries at the office as well, so I can anticipate what you probably had to field as well. The AC trade-up program is one of two, I guess I should move slides, is one of two air conditioning incentives that are currently being offered. It provides a higher per ton incentive for the replacement of low SEER units, and this specifically being 10 SEER or lower, and it requires the installation of a high SEER unit.
How high the SEER? What are you, 16 or what?
Right, to qualify, and I provide on the next slide a comparison. Essentially, we're just targeting the summer peak savings through early replacement of the older, more inefficient units. Here's a comparison of the two programs that we have. The AC trade-up program offers $500 per ton with a cap of $2,500 per unit, whereas the Energy Rewards is a prescriptive rebate program, and it offers up to $145 per ton with no more than 50% of the total cost of the unit. The AC trade-up, in order to qualify for this program, you do have to invest in a higher SEER, being the 16 SEER or 15 SEER. It depends on whether you have a split or packaged unit. And another eligibility requirement is that the unit must be operating. Whereas the Energy Rewards, a prescriptive rebate, there's no pre-existing condition or a specific SEER requirement on the equipment either being replaced or newly installed. However, for the Energy Rewards, a prescriptive rebate, you do need to install at least a 14.5. So it has to be above existing Title 24 conditions, so that we do ensure that it is a higher efficiency than just the basics that's required through Title 24. One of the number of questions that we've actually received that's been of particular concern with this program is the proof of the building permit, and I'll go into more about this later, but essentially the 10th SEER and the requirements for the new replacement unit, they're intended to encourage the early replacement. Whenever we there's two types of cost or energy savings that we use to calculate cost effectiveness of a program. And early replacement generates higher savings than just the natural replacement. So that's why we're targeting the early replacement. And also the $500 unit is intended to offset the cost. One of the reasons why it is a higher rebate is the fact that we are requiring a higher unit to be installed. And there is a substantial price difference between the 14 and the 16, sir.
Yeah, and that was what kind of threw me off, because when you made your presentation sometime back, mm-hmm. it would be a higher rebate, but at that time during the presentation, unless I was asleep, I didn't know you had to get a building permit and you had to have a more intensive deck work and all that. That wasn't brought, maybe it was brought up during your workshop, but not during the presentation.
Well, and we'll go into more about this Well, we'll go on to our next slide real quick, and then we'll talk about the building permits. Here's just a utility comparison of how we are programs measure up to other utilities within the state of California. As you can see, our program well exceeds what others are offering in the state. And while the majority don't require proof of a building permit, they do. There's a handful that require it, similar to our AC trade-up program. So it's kind of misleading, the proof of building permit requirement. Building permits are required, and that's actually California law. On the energy rewards, we haven't required proof of...
Backtrack a little bit.
Sure.
If a homeowner wants to install a new air conditioner, he needs to get a building permit from the city?
From county. It depends on what the permitting agency is, yes. In fact, I provided this morning, and I have copies on the back, or I provided before the meeting, this little green slip here is just a notice to contractors about getting the building permit, and it states that it is California law.
When did this go into effect?
January 1 of 2010. And it's, they also provided a website link here, so I included just for your review.
Sabrina, though, I mean, the air conditioning guys get the building permit, don't they? And then they just tack it on the bill.
They should.
That's what they've done in the past. Mm-hmm.
So typically they build that into their cost, or they could require that the, or request that the customer do it themselves. But either way, if you install a new air conditioner or you replace them, it is required that you obtain a building permit.
And that was started when? July? When
January 1st of 2010. And in the packet that I gave you, there's a letter to the homeowners, and then there's also a little letter to the contractors. And it's got a bullet list of the different conditions that would require a building permit. So going back to the program elements, one of the reasons that we do discuss or require the higher efficiency units and also the building permit and all the stringent requirements that we have placed on this is because we do have to conduct our due diligence to ensure that the programs are cost effective. There's five different approaches that are recognized in the energy efficiency industry, and we use four of the five as a calculations for, or the basis for our calculations and cost effectiveness test. And as a rule, as long as those that analysis comes up to one or greater, then the program is deemed to be cost efficient. This program, with the incentive being set where it is, it comes at 105 or 1.05. So we're barely making the cost effectiveness. Part of the reason that we use the building permit and require proof is to ensure that the units are properly installed. The building inspector will go out and verify and do a follow-up. And one of the things that that can prevent is, take for example, duct leakage. If the unit isn't properly installed, and there is, because there's a set requirement that the contractors have to ensure is met as far as the tolerance level for duct leakage. If that's over, isn't tested for, and it exceeds the limit, then the majority of any savings that we would see could potentially be going out into the attic or leakage, and we would never see, and we'd never realize the savings for it. So in order to ensure that this program is cost effective, that's one of the reasons why we required the building permit.
So say that a homeowner wanted to trade up to, a 16 SEER, and they had like a 10 SEER. Mm-hmm. When you include the cost of the building permit, you include the cost of having to rebuild the duct system, the cost of the new air conditioner, and so forth, do they really save any money even with a rebate to do all this?
We believe they do, and that's how we come up at the cost effectiveness test. I mean, is it more stringent than our energy rewards prescriptive program? Absolutely. You know, we are requiring more from the customers.
How much
we
more
feel
cost does the building permit and redoing the ductwork, how much more does that add to their cost?
Well, to be honest, I don't have those numbers in front of me. I should have brought my
I would have liked to have known what
spreadsheet.
Dave
would probably know that.
Do you know?
I believe that the building permit's around $35.
I believe you're wrong. I think it's more than that.
Yeah, they're definitely more than $35. I would say they're anywhere from $60, $65 to $137.
Don't tell me to ask him. He doesn't know.
He asked about the ducks.
Yeah, the permit itself, from what the research we've initially conducted, is anywhere from about $65 to $130, $140. I believe the city of Calexico has the highest building permit fees for the replacement of the air conditioner right now. With that being said, not all air conditioning installations will require duct repairs. They just have to conduct the test to verify whether it's within acceptable range limit, and I believe that may be 13%. I'm not sure.
Okay, I just, anyway, the person that called me didn't realize that you had to get a permit, you had to redo the duct system and all that, and this said, you know what, it's not worth it. It's going to cost me more, even with a rebate, to install this more energy efficient air conditioner. I guess he just got kind of disillusioned and disappointed and said, the hell with it, I'm not going to do it.
Well, in the building permit, I mean, it's a requirement of both our programs, not just one. We just have not verified it for the prescriptive rebate because it is lower, and the cost efficiency, we have more wiggle room in that. But on this particular program, with the incentive set where it is, we are, you know, walking a fine line, and we want to make sure. I believe all of you were provided a few weeks ago or sometime last month a copy of our M&V study. And this particular program, as well as our energy rewards prescriptive rebates, will be one of the programs that will be in the 2010 or our next year's measurement and verification study. And essentially, that's required by law to go back through and conduct a third-party analysis of our savings just to verify whether the savings that we generated and we're claiming under these programs are accurate. Go ahead.
So, Sabrina, going back to the activity since June 20th, 78 inspections have been done to date?
Yeah, despite, I mean, the new stringent requirements, there's a lot of interest in this particular program.
So 65 have been approved and they're going forward with the installation?
Yes. Just to kind of give you a feel for what that means, from about the same time period in 2010, we chose June 25th through July 9th because of the way the working days fell. We processed 49 rebates under the prescriptive rebates. In 2011, during the same time period, while we were running the AC trade-up program, we received 44 applications. So this higher rebate is definitely generating interest
even
despite
with the added
the higher,
expense, you're right. Still doing that. Okay, that's... questions or comments from the board?
No, I'll just say that I attended the workshop you had here with the air conditioning guys. I think it's a very good program. I think it was very well explained. And I think you're going to see more and more people going this route. So, and I know, Dave, getting back to the ducks, I know ducks are an issue. And I don't know if you got any comments on that, but ducting system in a house is very important.
Yes, sir. As you know, we're doing a small experiment on the
duct replacement pilot.
I'm trying to think of this metal ducts,
the sheet metal ducts,
mm-hmm. as opposed to the flex ducts, which are most cases out there, to see whether or not that is cost effective. Well, for the sheet metal duct, it's about $10,000 per home. For the flex duct, it was about $1,200 to $1,500 per home. So if you don't have decent duct work, you're essentially doing a very good job of cooling your attic when you have your air conditioner run. But whether or not the sheet metal versus the flex duct actually justifies the additional cost, I'm skeptical, but we'll find out over time. And I won't say anything more about the building permit cost.
Yeah, okay. All right, anything else? No. Thank you. Thank you so much for the update.
You're welcome.
Yeah. Okay, moving on to item number 10, page 90 on your agenda, Mr. Villalon, Water Department, General Matters.
Just a couple of small items related to water usage. A couple of weeks ago, our water use was expected to be about 10,000 acre feet over the projected.
Oh, we're over instead of under.
What's projected? Currently, we're running around 22,000.
Over?
Over the projected year-end use. That may be adjusted through the year, depending on what our approved order finally is set at. But we'll be tracking it.
Did you say, excuse me, Carlos, did you say 22,000 over as of today?
As of today.
And we were 66,000 over as of yesterday?
Yesterday morning, for some reason, they were showing 65,000. So we're going to follow up
and
with
them. And we were about 12,000 under last week. So
we've got going on?
Pretty erratic.
But
I will say that Mr. Villalone has consistently predicted that we would come in over this year, as opposed to the last 2 years of being very much under.
We will follow up to see how they're basing their projections so that
who's
we help
they?
Ourselves. Primarily Tina Shields, who deals with the Colorado River issues and water projections and water approvals.
So, Ms. Shields, your projections are accurate?
Yeah, the economic crops, it's called market-driven overrun.
These projections are not IID projections. They're Bureau of Reclamation based on operational studies. So I have sent an inquiry asking how they broke their monthly order down so we can see if we want to resubmit our operational data and reconfigure. You can kind of start over every time you ask them to put in new information. So we'll see what they have and see what their issue is. It's not normal for the fluctuation.
Yeah, that's
so it makes me think they're changing something in their model to trigger the inflection.
That's what I thought. Okay, thank you.
But the main thing is they're predicting an overrun, hay market's up, sedan market's up, everything's good.
I think what's more important is to think we're halfway through the year, and as a percentage, you've got less than 5% of a increase or decrease in IID's cumulative water order, and the measurement accuracy isn't that. So I think you have to take it with a grain of salt, and to the extent that we sell a lot of water this year, I'd rather be on the high side than the low side.
Right. Okay. Right. I agree. It's good for the local economy.
I think with the price of wheat the way it is, I think we'll have ground idle a little longer because they'll be holding off to plant the wheat. So I think that's going to cause it to shift go the other way, too.
That's correct. It could balance off towards the end of the year. We'll see. Plus, also, we'll follow up with the weather, see how
I couldn't help the weather changes. Notice Mr. Brokeen smiling whenever you talk about overruns.
We're selling lots of water. In reference to this past weekend storm events, the water department facilities did not experience anywhere near the damage the energy side did. We had some trash, some trees in the Calexico Heber area. But overall, the system fared well. We did have some power loss along the All-American Canal check sites, but they're running, and we're running on generators, so everything kept operating. So we were okay. We were spared, unlike the energy department. And unless you have any other questions, that's really all I have.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Villalon.
A quick question. Have you, Carlos, any issues on using the Brock Reservoir with water in, water out? Does it have any positive or negative effect upon the system?
When the Bureau does have water stored in there, it helps us manage our orders better. Water is there immediately versus having to pre-program it 3 days in advance so that we can more accurately respond to whatever day-to-day requirements are versus 3 days from now. So when the water is there, we use it. It's very useful.
All right. Thank you.
Okay, that's it. Thank you. Moving on to item number 11, page 91 in your agenda, Mr. Brokey.
Good afternoon. What I have before you for information this week, we'll bring it back for action next week. It's the extension of the Moss Adams auditing contract for years 11 and 12. You'll notice there are three types of audits that we're proposing that Moss Adams do for district each year. One, the audit services of 2011 would be the annual audit that they do. They do what we call a 401A pension audit for the pension, and then if necessary, they will do a single audit, which is required when we get $500,000 or more reimbursement from the federal government, and that We can't predict whether that will happen or not, but we're covered by this agreement if it is required, because you never know when an earthquake or a windstorm will come through and allow us to get reimbursed for those damages. When we Moss Adams has done the audit for 3 years, in 8, 9, and 10, and we first put the service agreement together, we didn't project the use of a single audit. We did not need a single audit for 9 or 10, but we need one for our 8 or 9, but we need one for 2010 because of the earthquake. And we recently signed a separate agreement with Moss Adams for, I think, $20,000 to do that single audit. It has to be done by the end of September. They're here this week already working on that, and we do not expect any problems about meeting those deadlines.
Do you intend to go on an RFP for services like this?
At the end of this 5-year period, yes, we will go out again and do another RFP process.
That was going to be my question. I remember, I think last time we passed it in 08, I can't remember, by law, are we supposed to switch companies every 3 or 5 years?
We can go up to 5 years.
Up to 5 years. Oh.
And so at that
so
point,
the 5-year ends when?
It'll be the end of 12.
2012. So
why is there 2013?
It'll be year 2012. The work will be done in 2013.
For 2012. Yeah, and then, yeah. So before that, you'll do an RFP? And
we'll do an RFP and do what we did back, I think it was in 2008.
Okay. So this is for information. You're going to bring this back at the next board meeting?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Not?
Yeah, I'd just like to say I've been happy with Moss Adams' work. I just want to make sure we stay within those accounting principles within those years.
Okay.
Been very impressed with their work.
Pardon me?
So I've been very impressed with their work.
Okay. I'll pass that on.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Stay there. Number 12, item number 12, page 95, the Energy Department refunding revenue bonds. Mr. Broking?
Yes, this is the third and final financing for the El Centro Unit 3 repowering project. It's estimated to be $75 million. We'll have it on next week for action. It's very similar to the other two financings we have. There's a preliminary official statement and an official statement, a continuing disclosure certificate, an escrow agreement, and a bond purchase agreement that we will ask for approval on. And then just jumping over to page 97 of the board package briefly, the timeline that we've laid out for this is informational item today. We had a rating agency call yesterday. I think it lasted about 10 minutes with Standard & Poor's. We have another one scheduled for, I can't remember whether it's Wednesday or Thursday. We expect it to be somewhere around 15 minutes. There's not a lot to add since our last financing when we did the second one. So there's not much update. And so the rating agencies are up to speed on the district. As I mentioned, next Tuesday we'll have it back for action. If board approves, then we'll release the preliminary official statement on the 20th. We have plans to go to New York to price the bonds on the 26th and 27th of July, and then we will close that first week in August.
Okay. Questions or comments? Not bring it back next week.
Okay.
Thank you. Moving on to item number 13, page 121 in your agenda.
Excuse me, if I could. I have Don Hunt with Fulbright and Jaworski here, and he's, as he's done in the past, he has a statement he'd like to read into the record.
Oh, you have to read it into the record? Come on over. Come on down, as I say the price is right.
Thank you, Madam President, members of the board. The documents presented to you for review authorize the issuance of not to exceed $85 million of electric system revenue refunding bonds and the execution and delivery of a resolution, escrow agreement, bond purchase contract, preliminary official statement, and a continuing disclosure certificate, all in substantially the forms presented at this meeting, with such additions thereto or changes therein as the officer executing such documents may require or approve. The board's approval of the bond purchase contract requires that the true interest cost on the bonds shall not exceed 6.5% per annum, and the underwriter's discount for the purchase of the bonds shall not exceed 0.6%. The approval by the board of the preliminary official statement relating to the bonds authorizes the general manager or the chief financial officer of the district to certify to the underwriter on behalf of the district that the preliminary official statement was deemed final as of its date within the meaning of Rule 15C212, promulgated under the Securities Exchange Act of 1934. Except for the omission of certain pricing, rating, and related information as permitted by said rule. The board approval of the financing documents and substantially the forms presented is the same process followed by virtually all public agencies in California. Because rating information, actual interest rates, principal amounts by maturity, redemption provisions, and related matters are often not known until after the date of board approval or until the date of sale of the bonds, it is valid and legal for the board to approve the parameters of the bonds and the authorizing documents and to delegate the approval of the final terms and details to district staff. This also allows for correcting typographical errors, non-material edits, and correction of an update to information relating to the district and the electric system as necessary, contained in the preliminary official statement. Once the bonds are sold, issued, and delivered to the purchasers, our office will provide the final execution version of the documents approved by the board, marked to show all changes made to such documents following the approval by the board. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
If I could add just one last thing, that we have draft documents on the table at the back of the room if anyone would like a copy of them.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Moving on to item number 13, page 121 in your agenda, geothermal issues. Director Hanks, you asked to put this on the agenda. You want to take it on?
Yeah. In talking with some of our local geothermal people, I was rebuilt to ask that shovel-ready didn't really mean shovel-ready in time for geothermal to get full benefits of the incentive program. And I would like to see the IID participate with the local developers and contacting our legislature and see about extending the credits to match up with the solar projects. Mr. Rogan's here. He could probably add more light to it if you want to.
Thank you, Director Hanks. Mr. President and members of the board, I'm Larry Grogan from Energy Source, and I have a couple of folders. I was just able to download a couple of documents, so if you want to later make a copy and deliver them to the board. But I'll just cover briefly the highlight. The geothermal 1603 expires December 31st, 2013. The solar is December 31st, I think, 2016. And what we would respectfully ask is that we at least go for 5 years and possibly give some sense to our lack of energy development policy within the government to as much as 10 years. What does this mean to us locally? We have obviously organizations that we are working with, the geothermal organization, and we have a number of other renewable energies that they have. We're all seeking extensions of biomass, Geothermal Energy Association, Solar Energy Association, and Business Council for Sustainable Energy, and who the hell is that? National Hydro. But these are all well and good, and they certainly make their rounds at their professional organizations out of Washington, D.C., and they make their rounds to the various committee chairmen, from Baucus to Camp to Orrin Hatch, to Senator Levin, as well as Senators Murkowski, and but the bottom line is that we ourselves are the ones that really put the iron in the ground. We are the ones that benefit from building these power plants, and it's our community that receives the tax benefits. For example, one geothermal power plant will pay approximately $120 million over the life in property taxes, $3.8 million a year. It will pay somewhere a little over in annual revenues, a little over $1 billion. The schools, libraries will receive about $28 million. Calipatria School District, although there's some question about that one, it will receive about $51 million over the 30-year life. So these are the benefits that come directly back to us, let alone the employment and sundry benefits from construction. About $120 million is labor that goes into the construction of one of these power plants. So we would ask that, and we would help with the letters and with the direction of the staff to contact our own legislators. I mean, this is Feinstein, Boxer, Filner, and have also our state representatives. Manny Perez is very supportive, and Senator Juan Vargas. And these are the people that we can contact, and certainly that means a hell of a lot more to them to have this project here than have a professional organizations out of Washington, D.C. that are always lobbying for something or other. So in that sense, I would ask for your support.
So, Director Hanks, would you like a resolution to come back at next board's meeting?
Yes, I'd like to, for us to pass a resolution and also utilize our lobbyists. We all see the expenditures that we have monthly, but have them working on our behalf.
Mr.
The motion, I'll second it.
Is that?
Yes, we'll prepare that. We'll come back to you. This would be for an extension of the production tax credit.
And we don't need a motion, Director Manville. This is direction.
It's that action. So.
Well, it's just
on the action item.
Mr. Graham's here from Cal Energy. Do you have any comments you want to make?
Larry did such a good job in explaining that. We totally concur with that. We have our people in Washington doing the same thing, working on that issue. And so any support we can get is much appreciated.
Okay, thank you. So, Mr. Kelly, you'll bring the resolution for adoption at the next board meeting?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Moving on to item number 14, page 122 on your agenda, approval of joint strike fighter resolution. Mr. Menville?
Thank you, President Mendoza. I brought this forward last time for information, and I know we have Diane Kaysen here in the audience, and I know that
there
was...
Go ahead, make a motion.
Okay, I was going to say, I know there was questions that Director Hanks had asked, and Mr. Colt talked to him earlier. He said he doesn't see any issues with transmission and the fighter group coming in, so I'll move for approval on the resolution.
Is there a second?
Second.
Director Hanks, what issues did you have with this?
No, I just, I was concerned about possible heavy-duty power lines going through that area.
And Dr. Koch, we don't have an issue.
No, Madam President. Only the hour line could possibly be affected, which goes from Dixieland to out towards Borrego Springs. And we have no problems with that line.
Okay. All right.
What I think Mr. Preston from Desert Springs Oasis has a comment to make.
Oh, that's a gentleman that moved forward, and then you move back. How am I going to keep track of you? You keep moving around.
I'll stay here for a second.
Okay.
Thanks. My name is Ron Preston, and I represent a project that's being processed out on the west edge of the valley called Desert Springs Oasis. And just wanted to introduce myself and our project. We've been getting a little bad PR lately, and we're starting a new public relations program so we can educate and inform everybody on what we're trying to do. And I want everybody to know that we do not disapprove of the F-35 program coming in out there. We think it'd be a great program for the Valley. And also, maybe it'll entice some of the guys that wouldn't normally come out here that they would see this project. It's a motorsport resort. It's not a not a retirement home like some people have made it out to be. Okay. And we're in the fourth year of processing this project, and to the letter of the law, and everything has been approved so far. And I've had to jump through a few flaming hoops, but we're getting there. And some of the supporters we've got on this project, we've got a 30-year Navy veteran that's now the manager of Churchill County, Nevada. His name is Brad Getz, and he sees there's no reason why we can't coexist out there. So just want to know, you guys, that we support the F-35 program, and anybody that thinks... Well,
thank you for coming forward. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
Okay, please vote. Item number 15, page 124 on your agenda, Salton Sea Authority Annual Funding Request. Mr. Kelly?
Yes, President Mendoza, members of the board, this item first appeared roughly a month ago. And at that time, I did ask the board to defer taking any action in as much as the Salton Sea is at the center of not only the contested QSA litigation, but the efforts to fix the Joint Powers Authority that's tasked with mitigating the water transfer's impacts on the sea. I fully expect that the board will want to go forward in maintaining its place as a member of the Salton Sea Authority, since IID is a founding member of this organization. But I do want the IID delegation to be mindful, as I'm sure you are, that the position of the IID board, as reflected in that February 2011 resolution passed unanimously, is going to be very difficult to reconcile with the position of the Salton Sea Authority, as I understand it. And so to the extent that you know, you're advocating for IID, it would be best if you point that out and try to get us closer to each other going forward.
And that's one of the reasons why I support being a member of the Salton Sea Authority, because we have to make sure that the IID gets its representation and represents the views of this board and this organization. So to me, it's worth it to pay the $40,000 and still become a member, and still be a member of the Salton Sea Authority. For that, is there a motion to approve?
I'll make a motion to approve. I'll second it.
Second. Discussion? Please vote. Okay. Thank you. Moving on to item number 16, page 127 on your agenda, Imperial Valley Regional Occupational Program Funding Request. Mr. Menville?
Yes, thank you, President Mendoza. I brought this forward last time as information, and I know Ivan Soto's here again to make a presentation, and Mary Camacho's here also. So, Ivan, you want to get up and give your presentation. And one question I have to ask, Ivan, I know that last time they talked about $30,000 for 1 year, and
yes.
I know now they have $30,000 for 2 years, and I'm not sure you were making a request for one year.
I believe that was some misprint.
So it's $30,000 for 1 year?
Yes.
I know Mary said she'd like to have 2 years, but I think that's pushing the envelope.
Quite a bit.
Due to the budget conditions. So it's 1 year, not 2 years as your request.
Mary wouldn't do that.
1 year.
Okay. I know.
All right, go ahead, Ivan.
Well,
you had some handouts, and then go ahead and say what you wanted to say.
I did.
But I'd be happy to move forward and make a motion that we approve funding for this project, $30,000 for 1 year.
Is there a second to the
motion? I'll second the motion.
Okay. We heard your presentation last time. It was a really good presentation,
Thank you. Very detailed,
and I really don't want to hear it again.
So. Thank you.
Okay. So please vote.
All right. Thank you very much, Ivan.
Thank you.
Moving on to number 17, page 128, Internal Auditing Section, Mr. Kaiser, Chief Internal Auditor.
Yeah, good afternoon, directors. I have no comments concerning general matters for internal audit. If you have any questions, feel free to ask
questions
me.
From the board for Mr. Kaiser regarding internal audit.
Yeah, do you have some to report coming up, some of your reports to get?
Yeah, we have a report coming in about a minute.
Oh, okay.
Concerning
besides that one.
Oh,
for next week, next meeting.
Yes, we have a water report coming in.
Okay.
And it should be on the next agenda.
Okay. All right. Thank
concerning
you.
A drain.
Okay.
And we have some reports following that also.
Is that the tamarack or what?
A rose.
Okay. Oh, the rose?
Yeah.
Okay, is there any questions? Not, Mr. Kaiser, thank you.
Well, and I'd like to introduce Frances. She's going to give an in-detail report on the 2010 P-card audit that you requested. This is a 10-page report. It's very in detail, and she's going to give you a conclusion and a summary of the issues, and then hopefully you've read the report, and then you can quiz her if you have questions concerning the recommendations and the findings of the report. But it's pretty in-depth, and hopefully you've done your homework.
Thank you,
okay?
Mr. Kaiser. You can sit down.
All right, thanks. I'm going to go sit down.
All right. This is number 18, page 129 on your board agenda. Mrs. Williams?
Yes, thank you. Good afternoon, President Mendoza and directors. Before I start my report, I wanted to apologize for some confusion regarding the graphs included in our report. They were not very legible. We've made additional copies, and they're available at the back table for the public, and hopefully you've received your more legible copies.
Yeah, we have.
Okay,
thank you.
As Chief Kaiser stated, I'm going to give a summary of the detailed report. And I'm reporting on the purchase card expense audit report. We examined P-card activities January 1st through December 31st, 2010. Our examination of more than 1,200 P-card transactions occurring during 2010 demonstrated to us that policies are generally working as intended, but compliance is not always achieved. In prior purchase card audit reports, we reported on unauthorized auto rentals, expense reports lacking signatures, and expense reports not accompanied by required itemized receipts. We identified similar transactions during this audit, but with less frequency. During 2010, the CFO's office issued two memos to clarify purchase policy 2465. These communications were distributed to all personnel in order to provide clarification regarding purchasing and travel policies and establish new practical guidelines. These memos address the types of transactions that we identified in this report and in prior audits, as well as addressing other related issues. We recommend and responsible personnel have agreed to incorporate the updated guidelines into relevant policies as stated in the CFO's memo and further reduce unapproved activity. During our audit, we identified control gaps within the P-card program. At the inception of the program, a schedule of standardized per-card credit limits was developed. The guideline was used solely to issue the initial cards. Currently, finance department personnel set credit limits based on amounts requested by department managers without consistency or standardization. Additionally, it is not uncommon for card users to exceed established credit limits. Current policy prohibits cardholders from using their P-card to obtain a cash advance. Accordingly, we have not identified such an occurrence. Nevertheless, based on information contained in the P-card population report, we believe that a control gap exists. The report clearly states a specific amount of cash available to many cardholders. Responsible personnel have stated that such activity will be declined through established program restrictions. However, we were not provided with evidence to support this assertion. During audit fieldwork, responsible personnel provided source documents to support the settlement process. The settlement process consists of various functions and does involve various district personnel. While some segregation of duties does exist, we identified a major control gap. The settlement process lacks a routine reconciliation of the summary report to the monthly payment made to Visa to settle the account.
Let's see.
The finance department is currently in the process of implementing a new purchase card program. Personnel have stated that these control gaps and others we have included in this report will be addressed during the implementation of the new CalCard program offered through U.S. Bank. We believe that the new program will provide the district with the capability to establish adequate internal controls for this process. The finance department reported that they are currently in the first phase of implementation. They anticipate full implementation by the end of August. Our report contains the following recommendations. Consider implementing mandatory training for PCAD administrators, department-designated employees, and other individuals involved in the approval process. Amend purchasing and travel policies to properly reflect the changes included in the CFO's memos dated July 1st and November 1st, 2010. Provide guidelines for the purchase of general and electronic equipment with purchase cards, including limitation definitions. Establish standardized card transaction limits and card credit limits. Define criteria and authorization requirements for exceeding established card spending limits. Improve established process of capturing and closing P-card accounts of terminated employees. In accordance with the district's ongoing effort to improve internal controls, consider amending the P-card settlement of SOP to include a routine reconciliation of summary reports against the monthly payment to Visa for account settlement. Establish a formal notification process for reporting late P-card reporting. Responsible personnel accepted these recommendations. We included their response in report in today's agenda. Are there any questions?
Mrs. Williams, I have a question. How many employees in the district are issued a credit card or a P card?
There's approximately 800 P cards issued.
Mr. Kelly, could I ask to look into that number? Perhaps there's too many credit cards out there that perhaps that number could be. What's the rationale for so many credit cards?
Well, there's more than 1,500 employees. When they initiated the program in 2005, many employees were issued a card. That number has been drastically reduced, and that happened in 2007. Based on the activity from the card usage and how many cards are out there, there's not too many cards that are not routinely used.
I think that number actually is closer to 1,350 employees.
Oh, thank you.
But you're normally right. But I want the record. And I think that 800 number is actually somewhat down from...
502 on page 138, you got 502 cards. That's correct.
What page is that?
138.
But well, I think in response to your query, Mr. Broking, if you might tell the board about the change that we're about to make.
Because what is that criteria for giving an employee a credit card? I mean,
do you want me to answer that? You want me to hand it over to Dr.
Well, you can, but I think if he could just would you chime in about the changeover we're going to make?
Well, okay. First of all, could you answer my question?
Currently, by policy, the manager or the supervisor would request a card for the employee.
Oh, so it's up to the individual manager or supervisor. We don't have like a set policy. Why are you going to be issued a credit card?
Not currently, no.
It's very loose and arguably
very loose.
Too loose.
Loosey-doosey. Okay, Mr. Hall, come up.
Good afternoon.
How are you going to change that?
Well, as she mentioned, we're going to be switching over to the CalCard program, which is offered by U.S. Bank. It's a different system and a different way of processing transactions. There are many areas that require some improvement, and I think we're going to try and capture all of these internal control issues as part of the implementation of the CalCard. And we've already begun a pilot program. We'll be looking at having IT and finance in the initial phase, see how things go, and then gradually roll out to the rest of the district.
So how does that differ from a Visa card, from a credit card, this CalCard?
Well, the CalCard, is a Visa card.
So but what's the difference?
One of the differences, well, the reason we're going this route, our current provider, which is First National, they switched the program on us. They made it mandatory that we move from a small business program to a large business program, and we're increasing the cost to us. And we had no choice but to either accept their increase in cost or go out and look for some other type of program. So that's what we decided to do, is go with the CalCard program. Now, the reason this is a little different, this program is only open to California governments, cities, districts, and so forth. So it's tailored specific for government usage. And it's a free program to us. There's no charge for
this.
There's
no charge at all?
There's no charge for this, no. And other than the normal interest charge, you would incur, but there's no late fees, there's no over limit fees. Basically, U.S. Bank has a contract with the state to provide this service to U.S. governments, and they go out every 5 years. I think it's three or 5 years.
So do you anticipate fewer cards being issued or more cards being issued since there's no charge?
I would like to see the number reduced.
Well, we anticipate that there'll be fewer cards.
Okay.
And to that point, we will be instituting a lot of new steps to control the number of cards that are out there. We'll standardize the credit limits of each card holder. Now, there are some people that require a higher limit because of the amount of travel they But we're going to have that process documented so that anytime someone comes to finance and wants to see how much, what is the credit limit for a particular person, they'll see it. If it's not the standard limit, then they'll see a letter in there from approved by the manager as to the limit they have.
So you'll be taking Director Menville's card away from him, huh?
You're going to have it, dude.
Okay. Thank you.
We'll have me on the blogs. It's not a minute.
I'm not sure who can answer this question. I'm not sure if Kevin or... on the first page on 130, from 2007 to 2010, there's almost a reduction of $1 million. How much of that was elimination of overspending or waste compared to reduction of travels and conferences, et cetera?
Do we know? I don't have the breakdown of what with the 2000.
I think you need to ask Mrs. Williams. Do you want to come? Can you answer that?
Well, this is strictly a general ledger historical account of spending. As to your specific question, I'd have to do further analysis to give you a better answer. This is very general.
All right, thank you.
Okay. Okay. Go on with your...
Were there any other questions for myself or Ed?
If not, could I have a board acknowledge receipt?
Move to accept or acknowledge.
Is there a second? You second it?
Second.
Please vote. Thank you, Mrs. Williams.
Thank you.
And thank you, Mr. Kaiser. Okay, moving on to item number 19, page 139 in your agenda. Didn't you do this already, Greg?
No, this is for our second financing.
Oh, okay, all right.
What we've been doing recently is after we close a financing, we bring back what we call a red line version that shows the difference between the documents the board approved and the final documents. And as you'll recall, some of the things that we don't know when the board approves the documents or the ratings from each of the rating agencies, the exact amount of the financing, the bonds by year or the interest rate, or the resolution numbers and the date the resolution numbers were approved. So then there's some minor other adjustments that are included in these documents, none of them which are substantial. So we just try to highlight, we do highlight every change that has been made, and this is performed by Fulbright and Jaworski, our outside bond counsel. So that's what's been presented to you, and we ask that you...
I'll make a motion to accept the red line version of the final financing documents regarding 2011B electric system refunding revenue bonds.
There a second?
Second.
Second. Discussion? Not. Please vote. Thank you. Going back to...
Number six
on the consent agenda, which is now an action item. Director Hanks, you asked to discuss this item.
Yeah, I just, I would like to make a request of the general manager to take a look at major work authorization 280. I'm very concerned about some of the risks of this moving forward as presented. I asked him to take a look at it for us and bring it back.
Yes, I believe that is the subject of a scheduled audit, and that will be coming forward to the board. I believe it's next week. The Rose Pump project.
Yes.
And I have read that report, albeit a little bit late, and I will be prepared to discuss it with the board at that time as well.
Okay. Any other questions, Director Hanks?
That's it.
If not, do you have a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
Is there a second?
Second.
Please vote. Okay, Mr. Kelly, is there additional business to discuss?
No, President Dozen, not.
Not? Then this meeting is adjourned.